If you've not been around Kingsway very long, you'll discover that your pastor tends to go to places where, I don't know, stuff happens. So this is my life. So, you know, I don't know what to say other than I just seem to be show up in times where stuff happens. And this last 2 weeks have been rather interesting. You know, I got to be very open with you. I would have preferred not to have lived the last 3.5 weeks in my life. I would have preferred that it would have been not even existed. But life isn't that way, is it? You live what you live. You know, I left a day after we put a dear friend to rest, his body to rest, and part of this congregation, and then walked right into this, you know, catastrophe in Haiti. I thought actually the week was going to be, differently. I mean, we had a plan, and I do believe it was the Lord's plan that we set out to do, but storms have a way of changing that. And I was on the way there. I really thought, wow, this is going to be an amazing trip because I got to sit next to Marshawn Lynch on the way down to Haiti, and I was thinking, wow, that was a. You know, of course, he talks about as much as he does on TV. But and I said to him, I said, well, can I at least get a picture? And he looks at me and goes, man, that's weird. I said, okay. But by the time we got to the Haiti and he had warmed up and it was, you know, he was there to do a good thing and help a school. And I guess Cliff Averill who's a Seahawk, work on a school, and they have a thing called Books and Bricks, so they doing a good thing. I think he somehow got out of Haiti faster than I. You know, the old U.S. government, you just got to love them, you know. They sent out a bulletin to the people and all the Americans in Haiti, you need to leave Haiti immediately. They did that, of course, 3 hours after the airport closed. Way to go, you know, our tax dollars at work, you know, right there. So that said, I'm not going to try to hide here. My emotions are pretty raw, to be very upfront with you. And, you know, 1,000 people died. You know, 1.4 million people are estimated homeless in Western Haiti. As I shared earlier, our 5 of our 4 square churches, the buildings were completely destroyed. And, one orphanage as well. Fortunately, the walls of the orphanage were cinder block, but, much of the other portions were wood and didn't survive. You know, the good news is that, you know, while they don't have much in Haiti, they all have phones. And, this is the ubiquitous communication. You know, by the way, that says something about the human need of needing to be connected. You know, I think that says something about the nature of man of needing to be connected. And fortunately, enough Haitians heeded the last-minute warnings that the death toll could have been significantly higher. Matter of fact, 1966 was the last time a major hurricane like this came through to Haiti, and over 15,000 people died. And so, but that said, it's still a significant event that is going to be very difficult for them to recover from for many years. I put together just kind of a culmination of some pictures of that we took, as well as the relief team that we sent out took, and a little bit of video. So it starts off with kind of the pretty pictures because Haiti's pretty. Well, most of it's pretty. And then it digresses into the storm. And so I'm just going to show that to you. It's about 3.5 minutes long to give you kind of context of my last week and a half, 2 weeks, I guess. So let's watch that.
Is it too late? Here in a place called Ravine Sable, and this is the church that we had, and it is totally destroyed, and this is the debris in the ground that you can see, and this is this lady who is taking care of the church, and they lost everything. We can see the house. There's nothing in the country. Everything is totally gone.
Wouldn't plan this, but Aaliyah, come up here. Aaliyah was is my 13-year-old daughter. She was with me. She was such a trooper. You know.
You didn't tell me when.
What's that?
You didn't tell me when I was
going to. I know. Surprise. Why don't you tell you what was a takeaway that you had? One takeaway.
Okay. So when there was warnings of the hurricane, I noticed that a lot of Haitians weren't doing anything, and because they said that they didn't really own anything, and so what they asked, what were they going to lose? During those few days while the hurricane was in Haiti, a lot of people lost their lives, and God gives us life. And even if we don't have anything, we still have life. And we should treasure that more than our stuff.
So. Yeah. Thank you, Suhar. So, you know, we were safe. I made the decision that we were going to hunker down in a place called Trinity Lodge. And it is a concrete structure that withstood the storm, the earthquake, so it was a solid place. The Christian owners there said that they had, you know, we have enough fuel for our generators for a month, and, you know, we were in a good place. And, you know, when the storm was coming, there was concerns it was going to hook east, and if it hit the body of it, or the eye would have hit the island of Hispaniola, which was basically Dominican Republic and Haiti, if it had hit the body of the island, it would have been significantly worse than it already was, and it already is worse in the sense of what happened. But, you know, so we were praying, and to be perfectly honest with you, it was a selfish prayer. It's like, Lord, let this hurricane run the gap. There's a gap between Cuba, Jamaica, and Haiti, and it's just a straight shot to Florida. And we were all praying, you know, as I told the Haitians, hey, you know what? The U.S. can afford this. You can't. And so we were praying, and it did hook towards the gap, but it didn't quite make it. And it went over the body of the eye of the hurricane. It went over Lakai, which is in the southern peninsula, and then Jeremy, both of which we've participated in putting wells in those locations. And You know, as this hurricane was swirling and taking place, we were there in our location for about 2 days. I just felt like the Lord was speaking to me so clearly. And one of the things that was the verse that came up was out of Romans chapter 8, when it says, you know, if God be for us, who can be against us? And there's a verse that says, God is for us, he is not against you. There's a translation that puts it that way. And, you know, and that is an important truth as a Christian, that you realize that God is for you. He is not against you. And this was a real live illustration of how God is for you and not against you. And it begs the question, why is this happening? Why is this happening? I mean, the earthquake in 2010 killed 300,000 people in 90 seconds in Port-au-Prince. Lakai and Jeremy did not experience anything that from that earthquake. They were completely, it's actually 75 miles to the west. There was no damage from the earthquake. And for those of you that have went with me over the last couple of years to Haiti, you know that they're still recovering from that. There are no natural resources. There isn't like a big piggy bank of forests and minerals and supplies on that island. It's a big rock. It's been basically the Haitian people were never given a real chance to be a nation. There's a dark side of European history in the sense of imposing things that have historic and even ramifications of today. And people that don't understand that don't understand the ramifications of history. And they just don't have the resources to recover from stuff like this. You know, how many of you have ever lived your life check to check, and you know that if something bad happened, you would have nothing to recover from that? Have you ever been in that? Well, that's an entire nation is like that. And it, you know, it begs the question, why did this bad thing happen? It's a natural question that people ask all the time. And I am often concerned when in the midst of when bad things happen, people that are around those people, that they're trying to come up with the reasons why it happened. And for the people for those that are involved in the situation where the bad thing happens, they're really not interested in others' opinions of what they think why it happened, because it doesn't help. It doesn't add anything to the moment. It's like taking salt and dumping it on a wound. The reality is bad things happen. And there isn't always a reason. But Jesus shares a story. There's a story of Jesus in the book of John, chapter 9, which you don't have to turn there. And it was Jesus and the disciples came across a blind man. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned that this man is blind? And his parents or himself? So who's to blame for this bad thing happening? In other words, you know, why is it this way? Whose fault is it? And Jesus makes a very interesting statement. He says, neither this man nor his parents. But this has happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. So he spit on the ground, made some mud, stuck it in the guy's eyes. He says, go wash, be healed. And the guy went and washed, and he was healed, and he went home. By the way, if you ever ask me, my eyes are hurting if I, you know, spit on the ground, and, you know. I'm telling you, Jesus did some stuff that would totally offend you today, okay? The truth is that he was saying this bad thing happened, but you know what? He's not going to give the answer that we all want. And sometimes we're not going to get the answer we all want. He did say, in the midst of this, good's going to happen. The display of my goodness is going to happen. So again, why did this bad thing happen? Why did a terrible hurricane hit Haiti to make 1 million people homeless? Well, we don't have the answer for that. And people that come up with answers, I have to argue with them, really, is that really helpful that your opinion is being aired at this point? What is being helpful is recognizing that God's hand could be known in the middle of this. In other words, whose fault is it? It doesn't matter whose fault it is. It happened. And God sees and knows all things. And we believe our God is sovereign and that he's loving and he's good. And the hard truth is when you are face something like this, it assaults your perception of who God is. What are you going to do with that? You see, Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 says, "For by him all things were created, things in heaven and earth, visible and invisible. In him all things hold together." I crunched that verse by saying, he's taking credit for everything. All things. I looked at it with that. All things. At the bare minimum, he created the environment of choice. How am I going to deal with that? How am I going to deal with that? You see, God doesn't tempt us, but he does create the environment of choice. And the world has been in turmoil since because of choices. You see, when bad things happen, God is good. What may have happened may not be good, because most this wasn't good. But God is good. And if I don't believe God is good, I will interpret everything incorrectly. Psalms 119, verse 60 says, "O Lord, you are good, and what you do is good." I think of Nebuchadnezzar, and you know, he went through a really difficult time. He had his entire life stripped away from him. He was humbled. He had a condition that he had came upon him, which his hair grew, and he went out like an animal, and he was in essence he was insane. And then he looked to heaven and cried out to God, and God healed him. And then in Daniel chapter 4, verse 37, it says this. It says, "Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, the great Babylonian king, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven, because everything he does is right, and all his ways are just, and he's able to humble those who walk in pride." In other words, I know this, I went through a bad thing, but God is just and always does what is right. And coming out of what I just experienced the last couple weeks, God is just and always does what is right, even though I don't understand it. And I don't think we're supposed to understand it. I think people that want to understand it generally are the people that are not going through it. It's more important to get through it. And I want to show you how to find good in the midst of bad. And I want to go to Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 28, and I'm going to read all the way through to verse 32. Then I'm going to have us read verse 28 together. Matter of fact, that's the first verse. So it's a famous verse, but it's also verse 29 together. Let's read this out loud. Let's go start here. "We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son." Now I'm going to, "and that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Goes on in verse 30, "And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he justified. Those he justified, he glorified." And then verse 31, "What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us?" That's a question. "He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things?" Let's pray. Lord, we just ask a blessing on what we're about to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. So it says here, "and we know." Say the word "know" with me. No. That word "know," when translated to, from the original language, literally means to see with perception. It's a verb, actually. It's an action. It's to look. It's to be aware of. It means purposely looking. Do you see? You could say, it could be, you know, we know, as you have looked, do you know this? Are you aware that God is working, and in the midst of everything, he is working for good? Do you see? Do you see? In Mark chapter 2, you have Jesus was at a house, and there was people came in Capernaum, and people came to see him. And the house was so full, nobody could get in. Matter of fact, the doorway is completely blocked. And the Bible says that he was preaching the word to them. Well, four men had a friend who was paralyzed. And they knew, they could see that God was working through Jesus. They knew that if they could get him to Jesus, something that it would happen. And they took it upon themselves to go to the roof and tear the roof off. And so four men brought this paralyzed man, let's put that up there, please, to Jesus, tore the roof off, and lowered him down. Okay? So they saw that Jesus was there. They knew. They took action. Jesus looked up, and he saw their faith. He perceived. He was aware. And then he made a statement, says, to the man that was paralyzed, son, he saw the faith of the men, but then he says to the paralyzed guys, he says, your sins are forgiven. Of course, the teachers of the law were very irritated by that statement. They didn't say anything, but they were thinking it, that he was blaspheming, and who can forgive sins but God? But again, Jesus was aware, he saw, and immediately in his spirit, he knew what they were thinking, and he said to them this. He said, you know that the Son of Man, that you may know, that you may be aware that the Son of Man has authority to forgive. He turns to the man and says, get up and walk. And the guy got up and walked and went home. And they were all amazed and they praised God. And in this, the men knew Jesus was working. Jesus knew, he was aware of their faith. And Jesus then demonstrated so that they would know. Do you know that Jesus is working? And when you know that Jesus is working, Jesus knows you, knows your faith. And then he will demonstrate it so that you know, those around you would know as well. This is how the Lord works. How we can make a statement and own Romans chapter 8, verse 28, when it says, we know. We have actively become aware of how God works. The journey of our faith is learning to be aware of God working, even in the midst of bad. Also good. It's sometimes easier and it's more pleasant to find, well, how God's working when the good things are happening. But when the bad things happen, it's not so easy. So I'm going to give you three questions. Three questions. And this first question may take a bit to get there. Where's the good? Where's the good here, Lord? Not just like in sarcasm, but literally wanting to be aware, wanting to perceive the hand of the Lord. Where is the good here? For every good and perfect gift comes from above. So where is the good? Sometimes you really have to look. You know, everybody wants to see the big thing, but oftentimes the good things are found in the small arenas, that God is at work. So where is he at work? To look and be aware. I know sometimes I want to see the big question, I want the big question answered, but you're not going to have that. The Lord is going to want you to look for the good. For the Christian, the answer to why is not always for us. But to know in your heart that God is working even in the midst of it. Depending on the challenge of whatever you're facing, it may take a while to get to the point where I'm talking about right now. Okay? It may take a bit. But here, be encouraged. While there has been a bad thing happening, good is at work. We need to look for it. Because God is for you. He is not against you. So, as the hurricane hits the island, I'm sitting there in this lodge that's not like a lodge you would think of. It's called Trinity Lodge. It's basically a concrete structure with dorm rooms and a couple private rooms and wonderful people. Great young man who's got a great vision for Haiti of wanting to see Haiti to become a prosperous place with good business ethics. Imagine that. Great place. So we're sitting there, and I'm thinking, okay. I was telling Ali, I said, you know, a lot of people are probably going to die tonight, and we're going to be okay. So let's pray for them. And as we were done praying, I realized that I had $5,000 in my pocket. Now that money was set aside for the team that was coming behind me, which got canceled, as you know that, to go do some work at the school. And it just, I did not sacrifice for that money other than just carrying it in. It was money that was given by this church, by many people collectively giving for the purpose of supporting the Tabar School, which has been our assignment for some time. So that was designated money. So I immediately got on the phone knowing that I had this money in my hand. I called the church council, or the governing body that helps oversees the finances of the church. And I said, you know what? I have this money. It's designated. Can we pull money out of savings and put it and replace that? And can I use this money to go purchase as much relief supplies as possible when the rain stops? You know, they all 100% said, absolutely do that. So this money was money that has been contributed to by this congregation. Now, some of you may not think that $5,000 is a lot of money, but you know what? In that moment, it was like $1 million. Okay? Because unless you had cash, it was not going to be easy to get things. And I knew as soon as the rain stopped, which, by the way, in our location, we got 12 inches of rain in 18 hours. Well, you know, there isn't like a stormwater retention system in Port-au-Prince, okay? It's just a lot of water everywhere. But as soon as that ended, we got in our vehicles and we went shopping, and it took us 3 days. And I got to be honest with you, shopping in Port-au-Prince is nothing like shopping here, okay? It is, it's hard. Not to mention you just had a hurricane come through. And, you know, I knew that if we got an early start, we would catch items before the prices spiked. Because of something like that, they're just going to go way up. And so we spent 3 days purchasing rice, beans, antibiotics, which are not easy to find, but we found them, tarps, you know, other items I can't just recall, toilet paper, stuff like that. And by the way, that's what you saw, those pictures of those trucks and the rice and all that. And we were able to collect most of that stuff. But during that time, we had not heard from our churches in Jeremy. Matter of fact, no one in Port-au-Prince had heard from the city of Jeremy for 2 days. It was completely cut off, and they couldn't get to them. And the Haitian government doesn't own a single helicopter. There was no way to know. Finally, there were some planes that got small prop job planes that started going out, and I got word from our denomination, because I was myself and one other pastor who came, I invited to come with me from Gig Harbor. we were the only American Foursquare pastors in country at the time. So we were, in essence, their representatives. They said, go get a plane and go and find those kids. And I'm like, I have my 13-year-old daughter with me. I am not going. And I talked to our Haitian counterparts. He's like, Mike, I just feel we're supposed to stick to the plan and equip these trucks. And as soon as that river's passable, because there's a major bridge that got wiped out, then we go. I said, you know what? I'm in agreement with you. We'll just not listen to anybody else and stick to the plan. Now, let me tell you, that was not easy. We don't know what decisions we're going to make, is what the effect of that is going to be in a couple days in this kind of an event. But we trusted the Lord. We trusted our, in essence, gut to make these decisions. And there wasn't really time to fast and pray and hear a word from the Lord. You just did it. And at the end, of that 3 days, we were we had made contact with the Lakai churches. And we, of course, put a well there. We had a team that people that went there. And they estimated 80% of the homes were destroyed in Lakai, that the storm surge had entered the entire city. So we're sitting there. We made contact with an organization that I happen to be connected to in our own community called Rotary Shelter Box, which is one of the largest disaster relief agencies in the world. And they show up and they basically provide shelter boxes, basically a box with tents, and basically if they lost their home, you know, here's a tent and here's some supplies, and you know, and thus. When we had spent that 3 days getting stuff together, I had to go hire some security, because you go into a disaster zone, you're going to need armed escorts to go in to make sure that your supplies get to where they're going. We managed to secure some off-duty Haitian police officers. I love the third world. we were able to get them all set up, but we were getting ready to go, and we connected with Rotary Shelter Box and met them. And by the way, one of their team members is from Squim, and a personal friend of mine called Scott, a guy named Scotty Robertson, owns European Auto Works right here in Squim. And we connected with them. They said, "Mike, we just got on the ground. We, you know, as usual, they don't have any infrastructures. They have to create everything. They have to figure out who's the trustworthy parties and who, you know, who they can work with." And I walk in with our Haitian pastors and sit down with them, and immediately they say, "Could you help us figure things out initially?" And so they were able to interview our Foursquare pastors, give them as much information they could. They said, "We need phones." We went out and purchased phones for them, got them set up in regards to communication. And then they then asked if our Foursquare pastors, they were leaving within 12 hours. And and I'm kind of jumping around here in the story, but it is quite a story. They said to us, they said, "Would you guys be our eyes on the ground? Would you give us our first picture of what's happening?" They handed them video equipment. They gave them forms to fill out. They said, "Because we have a ship off the coast of Jeremy is waiting for this assessment." So literally, our little convoy grew from just "let's help this" to potentially help a lot of people. Now, in the middle of all this, I'm making the decision not to go, because I have my daughter with me, and her and I had long conversations about the fact that she's not holding me back, because God does not want me there. The reason she was there with me, and I debated whether bringing her or not, all for weeks, and just felt, no, I'm supposed to. I'm so glad I did, because if I hadn't, I would have went. I would not be here right now. I would have went and spent the next couple weeks helping. But the Lord showed me, in the middle of all of this chaos, this bad thing, there was something good he wanted to do in our Foursquare churches and also in Haiti. And that is to teach the Haitians to help Haitians. There would not be the relief effort that occurred after the earthquake, and that they're going to need to really learn to help each other in a new way. That our Foursquare leaders were going to be in a new place of leader. They were brand new at leading, and this was their moment to really lead these Christians through a very difficult thing. And what will come out of that is a much more mature church. And so my daughter was along just so that Mike wouldn't go. And I heard the phrase from the Holy Spirit, "Haitians helping Haitians." So I'm in this meeting with Rotary Shelter Box, and I tell them what I'm thinking. I'm not saying, "Well, thus saith the Lord," because some of them are not believers and they think I'm cuckoo. So I just said, I just sense in my gut, this is what we're supposed to do. And that is, we need, whatever we do, we need to help Haitians help Haitians. And their eyes got about this big. They said, "We just left a meeting of the five largest world relief agencies just a few minutes ago, the UN Food Program, the International Red Cross themselves and a couple others, and they said that exact language was used on and agreed upon by all those agencies together. That the Lord was saying something very clear to those that were coming to help, that whatever you do, make it a priority, even if it is hard, make it a priority to help Haitians help Haitians. That this nation had the opportunity in this midst of a bad thing to become a nation, to become what they should be to each other, that they have not always had the opportunity to do. I see this as an opportunity for a unified work. And the Lord sometimes doesn't let us help, so something else will happen. You know, it's not just our Foursquare in Haiti, but also the nation, but also the island of Hispaniola. I read an article yesterday. Matter of fact, I was prompted by that, speaking to our Dominican Foursquare missionary, Charlie Finocchiaro, who has been a part of, spoke here many times, talked to me, and he says, Mike, he said, something quite amazing just happened. The president of Dominican Republic just met with the president of Haiti in Port-au-Prince, and they agreed on how to help this disaster. Now, anybody who knows the last year and a half of the history of that island has been marred by conflict between those two nations. Everything from immigration to imports to everything. Matter of fact, they both withdrew ambassadors here about 6 months ago. And, you know, there was potential conflict. And yet, here a bad thing comes, and what happens? Two potential rival neighbors decide to put down animosity and say, let's help, we're going to work together and help you. And the Dominican government was sending in large amounts of convoys of supplies as well as equipment, and they committed to rebuilding many of the bridges that got washed out from this hurricane. So in the middle of a bad thing, there was this amazing good thing happen with neighbors. So when you're wondering how, I mean, I'm hopefully I don't sound too scattered, but this whole event was just chaos and order at the same time. I call it chaotic. That in the midst of a bad thing, you should ask, it's at some point where you're able to ask the question, where's the good? Not like sarcasm, but really looking and being aware, because God is at work in the midst of bad. So where's the good? Romans 8 says, we know that God works good in all things for those who love him. That phrase, love him. So the second question is, do you love him? Do you love God? Do you love God more than you love your present comfort? Do you love God? How do I know? If you say yes in your heart, only you know, and the Lord knows. You know, it is, we are encouraged that to love God is to obey his commands. So you can look back and say, Lord, I've not been perfect, but I have done my best to obey you. I know I love you, Lord. You are the only one that can answer that question in your heart. Do you love the Lord? And if you love the Lord, then you can rest assured that he is at work even in a bad situation. Even if it doesn't make sense. Even if there's no answer to it. You can trust the God that you love is at work on your behalf. And he will restore. And when you look inside and ask that question, do I love the Lord? You're going to discover a hope that is unshaken by the present circumstances. There's a hope that is anchored in your heart that is not there by your own accord. but is there by the hand of the Lord. It is the promise of the guarantee of what is to come for you. I think of one of Colossians chapter 1, verse 4, when it says, we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love you have for the saints, the faith and love that spring from the hope that is stored up for you in heaven. That hope inside, when you reach that point of asking these questions, you will find that hope that's in you. And that hope is stored for you up in heaven. And it's not going to be shaken by this event or this situation or whatever it may be. So be encouraged. Continue in your faith. Establish and firm. Not moved of the hope that you have received. So two questions. Where's the good? Two, do you love God? And three, it takes a bit to get to here, but you can get there. How may I be the good? How may I be the good? So Romans 8:28, going back to that, when it says you've been, you know, we know that God works all things for the good of those who love and calling. Here it is, who called according to his purpose, and he gives them the purpose to be conformed to be like Jesus. The purpose of the good happening in the bad is to form us like Jesus. The reason we are on planet Earth as Christians is to learn to love like Jesus. And God intends to make us like him. That is his intent. This verse is making very clear it is his intent that he will use the good, the bad, and the ugly to make us more like him and to conform us to the likeness of his son, to form us like a potter. Pot, you know, forms a pot of clay. We have plans. We had plans. This was not my plan. I was supposed to preach at my brother's church last week. That did not happen. I got to spend 1 hour with him in an airport. You know, I was kind of disappointed in that. But when I realized the greater purpose of what the Lord had, I was okay with that. When bad things come along, it just seems like our plans get washed away. The truth is, all of our afflictions, our trials, our calamities, our persecutions, they are the means to often which God uses to form us to be like him. The Christian is made better by these inflictions, these things that happen, these difficulties. And they teach us the truth about our frailty, the transitory part of our life that this time on this earth is short. They lead us to look to God for our support. And to heaven for our final home. They produce a subdued spirit, humbled, patient, tender, kind. And this has been the experience of all Christians through the ages. And at the end of life, not at the moment, but at the end of life, we will be able to look back and say, that was good. In the midst of bad, for his purpose in my life. And one day we will see that things were permitted out of our welfare. Because God does not allow things into our life without design. And his designs are eternal, not temporary. Non-believers, when they go through bad things, it produces complaining instead of peace. It produces rebellion instead of submission. It produces anger instead of calmness. It produces impatience instead of patience. And it produces hatred instead of love. But that's not for us. There is a temporary good, and then there is a spiritual good. The world looks for the temporary good, but the Christian looks for the spiritual good because it leads to eternal good. God is forming us Why do bad things happen? I don't always know why, but I do know this: God is at work. And God's a good God, and he's in the middle of it. I referenced John chapter 9, the story at the beginning of the sermon. I referenced it, and there Jesus and his disciples came across this blind man. And as I shared the story, they were asked, why is he like this? And he said, no, you know, who's at fault? No one. And then they said, but this happened that God's glory will be displayed in this his life. And then he makes a very interesting statement that seems it's hard to understand. And it's this statement when he says, as long as it's day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. That's kind of an interesting statement in the middle of it. What is he talking about there? He is saying this. They ask the question, why did this bad thing happen? Who's at fault? And he says, no one. But God's purpose is that his glory will be displayed, and it's going to be displayed through me. There'll be a time where I won't be here, but right now I am. And he says, I am the light of the world. I'm showing you something. I am showing you what to do in the midst of when a bad thing happens. That good can come through your hand. Because Jesus said of us, he says, I am the light of the world. But then in Matthew, he uses that same phrase for us. He says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, you are the light of the world. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. In other words, let you be the good. That let you be the hand of the Lord. What it means to be like him is that when we are the hand of good, and you know what, our congregation, I was the representative, okay? I was just the guy that showed up. But the resources that we were able to put together, when it showed up in Lakai and Jeremy, those little kids, those 47 children, hadn't eaten in 4 days. And our trucks were the first to arrive. The trucks that this congregation paid for to go were the good, was the good in the midst of their bad situation. You see, that's how God works. That's how he works. And so what are you looking for? Now, I mean, put the distribution, those pictures up. You know, we went and bought peanut butter bread, and here they're just, the bottom picture there is Pastor Bilan. I asked him to keep good records, and he is so good about that. He'll tell me exactly who got what. You know, and there you are. I wasn't there because I wasn't supposed to be there. He was. I got to tell you, that took every bit of me to say that because I wanted to be there. But the fact is that's not the will of the Lord. So God asks us to be like him in the midst of hard situations. It sometimes takes us a while to get there. But he wants to get you there. So how do we do this? Well, for certainly in your own personal experiences and lives, you're going to have to answer those questions. And collectively, we were a part of that with what just happened in Haiti. I will be going back in the middle of November. It is made perfectly clear that that myself and Charlie Finocchiaro, we've been asked to go back and help do some assessments of the damage of the churches, in particular the orphanage. There's already a church back in North Carolina that's asked that if we would do that when we go, that that we would they would go back and rebuild it. So there are people there are churches lining up. We have a team that was scheduled to go work on the school. Well, you know, at some point it's going to go back, and it's probably not going to be doing what we thought. So there are going to be people that are lining up to help. Haitians help Haitians. But we also do need to help them now. They need more resources. They need to buy more food and go out there in the next week and a half. And, that was the breadbasket of Haiti. you know how long it takes mango trees to, I mean, mangoes are like apples to them, but they're all gone. The coconut trees, I mean, you saw what the, it takes years for that to come back. It's gonna be quite an effort. But all we can do is just do this. This is what we can do. We gotta be content with that. So what I'm gonna ask our congregation over the next 2 weeks, now you give sacrificially many times, and you give, you know, many of you give your tithe, you give a tenth of your income to the Lord, continue to do that. That's under the Lord, and it allows us to keep going. But I believe that every family in this church, whether it's small or great, some of you, it's just gonna be a little bit, some of you can do more, that over the next 2 weeks that we give above our tithe and we help our Four Square churches with another gift. And so when I'm, the next 2 weeks in the back right by the sound booth, there'll be a little, matter of fact, Shane, would you move that other basket so that's very clear that it's there? There's a basket back there as you're leaving. You can put something in there, or if you need to go home and think about it and come back, it'll be available next week. I want to encourage you that doesn't matter. The amount is not what's important. What's important is what you know in your heart you're supposed to give. That you make a decision in your heart as a family, and we'll collectively do something together. So with that, that's how we respond. I want to encourage you, bad stuff happens, but when it does, God is at work. He is working, and we need to look for it. Because when you, by the way, when you see the God, work that God's doing, it brings a spring in your step when your head's down. And he is working. You just got to look for it. Let's pray. Lord, I just give thanks and ask a blessing upon all that has been heard, Lord, that you would help us, Lord God, help Haitians, help Haitians. Lord, you orchestrated stuff this last week that I am just amazed at. So Lord, we recognize that you're, but Lord, we want to also be an additional help, Lord. So we pray that you speak to every family in this congregation to decide in their heart what to give, not out of necessity or compulsion, Lord, but a generous gift that is cheerfully given, be upon every family member. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Would you stand, please? I know that was a wow moment, you know. I told my wife, I said, I really like doing stuff like that, but yet I know God has assigned me in school. This is my church. This is where I'm supposed to, I'm the pastor of Kingsway. But part of our assignment as a church isn't just to sit and swim and just kind of live in our nice little bubble and be happy Christians. But do some work. Help. Do good. Be the hand of God. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And have a wonderful and blessed week. God bless you. Take care.